looking for the King of Podcasts? You're in the wrong channel. Looking for good ideas for life? You are far from good hands. If you think the listener is always right, you are far from the right place. Hosted by a Northeasterner by birth, a rebel by choice. If you want a host that floats between love and madness, then play on and listen to Crazy Train Radio.
What up, Crazy Train Radio?
You want answers?
I think I'm entitled.
You want answers?
I want the truth!
You can't handle the truth!
I love scotch. I love scotch. Scotchy, scotch, scotch. Here it goes down, down into my belly.
Don't mess with me, I'm one crazy mofo.
With over 30 years of experience and a superb reputation for being a detail-oriented company, Lacey Cleaning has some of the highest work standards in the cleaning business.
That's the fact, Jack!
Whether it's carpet cleaning, tile, grout cleaning, new construction cleanup, rental turnovers, vent and duct cleaning, odor elimination, office and or business cleaning, power washing, residential cleaning, you name it, they do it. Check them out. To contact them today, LaceyCleaning@gmail.com or call them at 609-709-8536.
And that's what I'm talking about.
Hey, I know we have a lot of horror fans that listen to our shows, and I know things have been tough for everybody across the board these past 6 or 7 months with what's been going on in the real world. But I wanted to make a suggestion to you horror fans, because I know part of the normal routine year in and year out is to attend different conventions to meet some of your favorite horror stars. However, none of us have been able to do that because of obvious reasons. But I do have a little suggestion for you. SignatureHorror.com. Now, some may ask, what is that? Well, they obtain autographs for the fans from some of their favorite stars, from some of their favorite franchises. Whether it be the original Texas Chainsaw Massacre, Friday the 13th, Nightmare on Elm Street, and many more. They have different options, such as, besides getting their autographs, you can do live Zoom calls with your favorite stars. You can do personalized videos for people, greetings of some sort. They just have many options. So if you're looking for to spend some money that you may have spent at conventions, check them out and see the options they have. SignatureHorror.com. That's right, SignatureHorror.com.
Everybody, this is Brooke Theiss, your favorite bug girl from Nightmare on Elm Street 4, and you are listening to Crazy Train Radio.
Hey folks, it's your least favorite host in a podcast world, Croc, Jonathan Steele.
And I'm Elena, your favorite host from the Emerald Isle.
Boy, do we have a good one for you today.
This next guest is known to the mainstream audience as everybody's favorite bug girl, Debbie, from the widely successful Nightmare on Elm Street 4 Dream Master. However, like an onion, she has many layers and many roles, besides her appearance on the Mickey Mouse Club. But the most important title for her is mom and wife. Let's welcome Brooke Theiss.
Yay! Hello, everybody!
How are you this morning out on the West Coast?
That was a very nice introduction. Thank you. Thank you. Everything is good. We're getting cool here, which is probably warm for everybody else here. It's like, you know, walk around in the morning, it's 40 degrees. I'm like, oh my God, I'm going to die.
You're not a cold weather person?
No, I am a lizard, so I do not like the cold.
And I know the newest hiree, Elena, has been excited for this.
Yeah.
From when I said, yeah, guess who's coming on, weren't you, Elena?
Yeah, I know Brookie. We've met a couple of times, and I have to say, this is such an honor to get to interview you like this.
Oh, so fun.
Well, I will say, full disclosure, that, and I know you two talk on Instagram and stuff because of the time differences, but I will say that Brooke was putting Elena over, as they would say in wrestling, for saying how excited and how just nothing but positivity for Elena. So that's definitely a good thing.
Yes. Aww. Yes.
You know, I'll stroke her ego a little bit here. Might as well tell her.
Right. Exactly. He asked me about you, so I put in a good word for you.
Oh, thanks, bro. This is a great day.
Just don't cry until afterwards. You look like you're about to.
I'm not going to cry. I'm a professional now, okay?
Okay. Oh, boy. So, first and foremost, I want to jump into the personal thing. I noticed, and we know everything on the internet is true.
That, right.
Yeah, that Dad was a Western actor. Plane, who was a villain in most of his roles, and mom was a model.
What? That's too funny. Yeah, so my dad did, both my parents were like, you know, aspiring actors and had done some stuff. My dad went to UCLA, and my mom was from New York City. So yeah, my dad did a couple of Westerns, and I wish I knew, I can remember one of the titles, and now it's totally blanking because I didn't even think I'd be asked this. So yeah, so he did some Westerns, and my mom was actually a really pretty successful model in New York, even though she was only 5'4" at the time. At the time in the, I guess, 50s, thought you had to be 5'8". My mother desperately wanted to be taller, but she kind of looked like Grace Kelly. And so they just loved her look, and she worked a lot. So I used to go through her her modeling book and see all her tear sheets and stuff. And I remember after I got married, I looked through it again one day, and I was like, oh my gosh, mom, you did a advertisement for Genesee beer.
To alcohol, the cause of and solution to all of life's problems.
Which, you know, my last name is Genesee. So we were laughing about that. So.
Oh, boy. So would you say you look more like mom, or are you a mixture of both parents? Because obviously it helps that, you know, mom was a model and everything.
Right. Well, I mean, yeah, I kind of look like my mom. I definitely don't look like a model. I never modeled in my life. So, but
that's
I look more like my mom.
That's a total lie.
No, I couldn't. No, I could not. It was, my mother is gorgeous. I fall short of her. So, I look like more like my mom. I have her smile, and but I have my father's coloring because he's German. So I'm very blonde, and that's definitely from the German side. And then the other side is Jewish, and so I don't know what I am over there. So the blonde and fair skin definitely is like Northern Ireland, not Northern Ireland, Northern Ireland, Northern Germany, I think.
Yeah. But that's why she looks
Turkey treat the turd.
I knew this is going to make it into this.
I can't help it.
Yeah, but to be honest, if I actually said it in my own accent right now, it would sound like 33 and a third. But if I want to ham up the Irish, typical thing, it'll be 33 and a third.
Oh, thank you so much for doing that. I love it.
That one was coming.
I just wanted to say, I saw this ad, or not the ad, the trailer for a new film called Wild Mountain Thyme with Jamie Dornan and Emily Blunt and Christopher Walken. I got to be an extra in that movie.
Oh, but, fun.
When I saw the trailer for it yesterday, my heart literally died inside because the accents are so bad.
Must be hard when accents are hard. I'll be honest, I'm not very good at them. If I do one, I have to study really hard. So, I mean, especially when you're from a certain region, you hear it immediately. We do our best, but oh my gosh, I know. It must be really hard when you hear accents and you're like, oh, they butchered that.
Because one of the guys was actually Irish in the film, and then he just managed to sound bad. Like, it's just...
Oh, isn't that maybe funny?
It is so bad. But anyway, so back to you, Brooke.
I was going to say there before we got talking about accents, because we were talking about looks and who she looks like and all that fun stuff. And I didn't see a ton of it. I'm not familiar with it. But apparently you bear resemblance to Maxi's series of dolls. What in the hell was that all about?
Oh my gosh. That was actually one of the coolest things I've ever done. So I somehow won the role of doing all the commercials for Hasbro's new fashion doll, which was called Maxi. And I had done a couple of interviews, and then they told me I had booked the job and I was over the moon. So I won a 5-year contract with Hasbro to play the live, the live representation of Maxi. So they flew me all over the world. I shot in Australia. We shot the commercials in Australia several times, in New York several times. But then I also traveled the United States talking to girls. And I had a huge script and talked about, getting an education and being true to yourself. And it was really quite incredible. It unfortunately only lasted 2 years because she just couldn't compete with Barbie. But I tell you, that was a really cool contract that I booked. So I was very, very honored to do that. And the commercials are pretty funny to see. I did so many of them. So I had the most incredible wigs. They were like, I don't mean to talk about numbers, but they were like $10,000 wigs on my head. They were made by Dolly Parton's wig maker. I had everything like to the T in terms of my costume, down to like my earrings and the things in my hair were like mirror images of this little doll. So it was pretty cool. I actually have a funny story because Meryl Streep is like my idol, right? So I'm in New York City and we're in some, tall building that are a bunch of studios, and I'm shooting and I'm in like this nightgown thing scene. We did all the vignettes of the doll, so the dolls in the pajamas, and then she's having a pajama party. And so then they would switch to me having a pajama party with my little friends, which were my other little doll friends in the series or in the line of the fashion dolls. And so somebody's like, oh my gosh, Meryl Streep's on the floor. I'm like, shut the front door. And I was like, I gotta go find her. So I go into the bathroom and she's in there with her little girl. And then she's walking out and I finally have the courage to walk up to her and shake her hand and say, oh my gosh, I just love you. And you're the reason I became an actor. And you're totally my idol. And as I'm walking away, I'm like realizing I'm in this pajamas with this wig on, and I look like a living fashion doll. And I'm like, oh my God, she's probably thinking, what did I inspire?
Oh, Jesus.
Don't mess with me. I'm one crazy mufu.
I love that so much.
But it was very cool. I still got to meet her.
That is so awesome. Okay, so I'm going to take over, Brookie, and I'm going to jump in, and I'm going to go straight for a little show called Just the Ten of Us. And I'm going to say, just before I get started, that it's going to frustrate me because we can't get the full box sets because of the copyright and all that stuff. But I just want to say, from what I could see and what is available to see, there's enough to identify with your character and know that all the girls in the family have different characteristics. And it must have been, you know, really pivotal for young girls and everything to be able to relate to a certain show and look up to you guys and the hair and the outfits.
Oh my God, the 80s, right?
It was so good. Yeah, I'm still going to ask you how to do your hair, you know.
Just a lot of backcombing.
So just to start off, what was it like working on a successful TV show for 3 seasons?
Yeah, so Just the Ten of Us is so near and dear to my heart. I don't know how I got so lucky for that to be my first series, but I literally am still friends with all of them, like from Bill Kirkenbauer all the way down. Deborah Harmon, who played my mom, is like my second mom. I text these people and talk to these people weekly. And Joanne Willett's son was a roommate at Joanne's son went to Berkeley. My son went to UC Santa Cruz, and then his girlfriend went to Berkeley. So they were roommates. And I was like, can you believe they're roommates? So when I saw him on like in video in utero, and then now our children are rooming together. So they're very close to me. So I was very lucky to work on that show. We were truly a family. When you hear people say that, I don't know if they really are, but we were such a family, and it was an instantaneous kind of thing. And it was so fun. It was so fun. Yeah, so all the characters were all a little over-exaggerated a little bit, 80s. But also that's, you know, I learned that's kind of what the producers do. Like in the first season or so, they kind of over-exaggerate characters so people can identify, and then they kind of start calming them down a little bit. But yeah, I was the boy crazy, you know, mischievous girl, and she was so fun to play. I just loved my character, Wendy, and she was crazy and funny, and, you know, all she thought about was boys, and she was fun to play.
Well, it's I was going to say, she was so boy crazy. There was this guy apparently on the show named Litz that she ended up meeting and marrying years later. So go ahead, Elena.
Do I make you horny, baby?
That's right.
That's right. So, Brookie, did you find delivering comedy challenging?
Yeah, comedy's really hard. I mean, you know, that people always say drama is hard, but comedy is really hard. Timing is really hard. And I love that sitcom format's my favorite. If I could do another sitcom, I would be there in a heartbeat. I love the format of being able to rehearse all week. I love the format of putting it up in front of a live audience. So it's kind of like doing a play. I love the multiple cameras. I love working a scene, a comedy like that, you know, all week is really great to be able to work out the kinks. And I love sitcom comedy, and I love slapstick. I love physical comedy. If I have to fall down the stairs, I'm like, I'm in. totally in. So, and I'd always try to find comedy, physical comedy with my character, whether she was coming down the stairs in a costume and the costume knocked down all the pictures off the wall and, you know, climbing through windows and stepping into sinks full of water. And so she was really fun. So, yeah, just physical comedy and comedy in general is very challenging. But when you do a scene and you know you nailed it and everybody, all the players were like, yes, it's very exciting, very thrilling.
And were you nervous to sing?
Oh, God, yeah. I am not a singer, although all I wanted to be when I was young was a veterinarian and a singer. So I love to sing. I know, right? Oh, so I love to sing, but I'm just not trained. I'm not a horrible singer, but I am not a trained singer. So I don't have a lot of confidence, but we had a lot of fun. We actually worked with a vocal coach, and the first episode that we sang live. And that was, I think it's technically, it was hard for the producers and to make it all work singing live. So then after that we lip synced, but it was us. We just went into the studio and recorded, and that was a little easier, a little more controlled. And especially for me, who, like, you know, if I hear another, I'm like tone deaf. Like, so if you go on another pitch, I'll go over there. And if the person next to me goes a different way, I'll go over there. So it was better for me to be kind of in a controlled environment and be able to pre-record them. But it was so much fun. And I don't know if you guys know, but we sang the national anthem at Dodger Stadium, which was another feather in my cap. It was like so cool. I tell people that and they're like, no. And I'm like, yes, isn't that cool? And I can't find a video of it. I'm gonna have to ask the producers, if one of the producers, if anybody has that on tape, because that was really, really fun. I remember we were walking out and they were like, okay, so you have to be really aware of like the bounce back. So when you're singing, your voice comes back to you like 10 seconds later and you're like, oh my God, it's a really,
it can throw you off.
Yeah. 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 So at least they had told us that. So we were like very aware. And I stood next to Jamie Lunar, who played my twin sister, and she was a very good singer. So I was like, okay, just Jamie, let me stand on the end of you, so nobody's to the left of me and I can't hear anybody else, and I'll just stay with you. And that's what we did. I just, a lot of times I sang next to Jamie.
And the good thing is she sang so well that they invited her as a guest on the Mickey Mouse Club, as we said. I'm going to insert clip here of some of that.
Oh, my God.
Hey, everybody. It's me, Mickey Mouse. Say, you want to come inside my clubhouse?
12-year-old Jennifer Crawford from Castaneda, Texas, and 12-year-old Karen Hoffman from Humble, Texas, are best friends. They told us that they'd like to spend the day with one of the stars of TV, just the 10 of us, Brooke Theiss. We arranged for them not only to spend the day with Brooke, but with Brooke and her best friend, Michelle Roberts. Here's what happens when best friends get together at the Redondo Beach Pier in Redondo Beach, California. Watch.
That's hysterical.
That was the exact reaction Elena said we'd have.
I know. I'm like, oh my gosh, it's crazy.
Yeah, we don't have the Mickey Mouse Club over here, but I certainly have heard about it because, you know, Britney Spears and Justin Timberlake and all of those people kind of started out in those. So yes. I was able to understand what the show was supposed to be. And when I saw the clip, I was, this is just gold. This is the best thing I've ever seen. It's like, why don't we have shows like this?
Right? Oh my gosh, yes. And that was such a popular show. And gosh, boy, did it catapult a lot of young actors and singers into the industry. It's pretty amazing little place to start.
And crazy. Sorry, Elena, full disclosure here. She can't see my phone, but I just picked it up. And to answer Brooke's question, yes, it'll be 8 o'clock.
Thank you. Yes. Perfect. I just saw a 10:30 Zoom call. And I was like, yeah. Oh no, did I get it wrong? But no.
East Coast time.
Yes.
Okay, so any funny memories of the show that really stick out in your head, in your memories, Brooke?
There's so many memories, but I will tell my one funny story. It was the second episode, season one, and the parents go camping or something like that. So we had this whole like camping nature set full of trees and rocks and dirt. And I'm a really pretty outgoing person, but sometimes in certain settings, I'll be a little quiet and shy until I kind of know all the players in the scene. And so I was probably, you know, being quiet or whatever. And I remember I hear my mother, Deborah Harmon, say, "Go, psst, Brooke." And I'm like looking for her. And I see her. She's like bent over BA-ing me, bare-assing. I don't know if anybody knows that in Ireland. But she's like mooning me. There's so many terms for it. And I was like, "Oh, my God, Deborah Harmon." And she's like, "Man, I had to bring you out of your shell."
That sounds like so much fun.
Oh my God, I can't believe you just mooned me. And we were to this day, we laugh about it. So very, very funny.
So to end my little segment on just the 10 of us, I will ask this electric question.
Oh gosh.
Way that I learned. So where do you think Wendy would be now in social media and all this? What do you think she'd be doing?
That's so funny. So, you know, I think most people think that like Wendy would be like a stripper by now, but I actually think Wendy would take a turn for the better. I think she would get past her teenage, you know, boy crazy years. And I actually think she would become like, I don't know, something really smart, like maybe a lawyer or something. Cause she was pretty convincing. She could definitely negotiate her way out of anything, and she can convince her sisters to do whatever she wanted. So I think she would be a lawyer by now. I think she would have outgrown those crazy times and be a real force for women. I'd like to think that.
Awesome. You want to jump in, Jonathan?
Yeah, sure, why not. Well, I was thinking, and obviously mentioned it during the intro there, that many people also know you for some little role with the name Debbie from Nightmare on Elm Street.
Hey, baby, you're sucking on the wrong nozzle.
Hey, yo, needle dick. I bet you're the only male in this school suffering from penis envy.
Da-da-da.
I know, scary. And I know Elena's got an opinion on that. As she told me yesterday, we'll let her get that out as well. But can you tell us about the audition process and how you got the role?
Yeah, so it was just a normal, you know, interview. And then I did the first interview, and then you get your call back. And I remember I got the call back, and I went back and I read it again. And then I think I had a third call back, and it was with the director. And I remember we were on camera, following us around the room, and we were doing, which is not usually common. So usually you just sit in a chair and everybody's at a table, you know, and they're staring at you. But Rennie Harlan was really cool. He was there with his camera, and he was following us around as if we were already filming the scene. So he really kind of wanted to get an idea of what we, I guess, look like on camera and how we played with each other. So I remember that very well. And then, of course, I remember getting the job, getting the call that I had booked the movie. And, you know, as a young actor, you're just, even as an old actor, I get a job and it's so exciting. It's just like, ha-ha! My father used to always say, relax, you're on vacation, because an actor's job is to interview, and that's your job. And once you actually get a job, you're on vacation. So I was like, yay. So that was very thrilling. So I was very excited to just book a gig.
Right on. Elena, do you want to elaborate on what I hinted there?
What you hinted? yeah, I was just going to say, in case you didn't know, Brookie, I'm a fan of Nightmare on Elm Street.
No.
Really?
Yeah, in case you didn't know, but yes. So I just wanted to say, like, personally for me, Debbie's demise is like one of the most inventive, super gross, but like visually mind-blowing of the series to me, because I have arachnophobia and I get really antsy around bugs. So whenever I see that, I just kind of like impacts me like way more.
That's so funny. That must have been like, you could have totally hit home with understanding that character.
Yeah, totally. But also, you get bonus points in my heart always because of Sinead O'Connor's awesome workout song.
Right?
So yay, Ireland.
Yeah, I know. She was, the music in that movie is so good. It's so good.
So I had a kind of random eclectic question again, because that's my new favorite word. I wonder who called me that word.
Yes, the eclectic question. Love it.
But I wanted to know, is there any characteristics of your character, Debbie, that you saw in yourself, or do you actually, can you relate to any of her? Because I kind of, you know, you see her being working out and stuff, but I felt like deep down she was a kind of a strong character, and unfortunately didn't get to kind of show it as much. But do you ever, you know, with your characters, can you relate to her in a particular way?
I think the one way I can relate to her is I hate cockroaches. So, and the funny thing is I love bugs, and so my favorite bug is a praying mantis, and I make sure I cup spiders and get them out of my house. I never kill them if I can help it. So, but I hate cockroaches. I used to go to Florida and visit my grandmother every year, and their cockroaches there are huge. And my brother used to overturn like rocks and stuff in the backyard because he was a boy and I was a total tomboy, and he would unearth all the freaking cockroaches as they would go scattering, and I was just like, oh my God, that's disgusting. I thought that was horrible. But so yeah, so cockroaches is, I think, my relationship with Debbie, because I'm a tomboy and I like to climb trees and do that kind of stuff, but I never saw myself as a very strong kind of character. I was a cheerleader and I danced and all of that kind of girly kind of stuff. So I think maybe my inner child came out with Debbie, because I was very tomboyish, like I had said, and you couldn't really mess with me when I was a kid. But as I got older into my teenage years, I became more of a girly girl, and so I think I'm a happy combination. But back then I was like, you know, I worked out a bit, but she was like, you know, put my bike over my shoulder, and she was just a badass. So so I think like I said, I think Debbie brought out my youth and myself, and that kind of toughness and belief in myself.
Side note, because you mentioned praying mantis there, and it got me thinking to a couple weeks ago, with, because it's still kind of nice, but changing over.
Yes.
Weather-wise here on the East Coast, and we had a, everybody's in my house now because of COVID and all that fun
stuff. Yes. Yeah. Fun.
It's me and my parents again, which is hilarious.
I love it.
But so we had this. So my niece and nephew came over. We were talking about when we were shooting the breeze before we started recording.
Yes.
My niece is 3 years old, and we had a praying mantis about yay big on my front screen door.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah.
Big.
Yeah. This was a big praying mantis. And my niece is like, oh, I need it. I want that. Became her pet and named it Fancy Nancy after a Netflix show.
No. Oh, my God. That's hysterical.
This kid's a trip.
They're fun. Actually, I had a pet praying mantis, and we kept him in this big aquarium for the summer or whatever, and we fed him meat with tweezers, and they are fascinating to watch them eat. And then we let him go or her, I think it was a female. I think they're all female. Is that correct? Like they mate and then they eat their male. I'm not really sure. But anyhow, then we put her on a tree, and she laid an egg sack, so she was female. So they're fascinating. They're fascinating bugs. Cockroaches, not so much.
Well, before I let you, go ahead, Elena, sorry.
I was gonna say, you guys keep talking about all these bugs, and I genuinely only get to see those kinds in like documentaries and movies, because in Ireland, as far as I know, we don't have cockroaches, and they were very rare. We'd see a praying mantis.
I'm moving to Ireland. I guess it's just too cold, right?
It's too cold, exactly.
Yeah, it's too cold.
So with the makeup effects on that side of things, I've heard the name on several occasions from several different people, but maybe you can describe a more Screaming Mad George.
Oh my gosh, Screaming Mad George is a hoot. He is this little Asian, when I first met him, so he's this short little Asian guy with like multicolored hair, and he literally, I'm not kidding, laughs at everything. He's like, I made this. Oh, look at this. And you're like, oh my gosh, he's like fabulously crazy and super talented. And I was just really fortunate to work with him. I'm still friends with him, so I again cherish that relationship. So
I'll have to send you the video I saw this morning. There was a video on YouTube from a like behind the scenes and some of the makeup.
And yes,
but there part of the video you could see George. I think it was George. I know you saw him laughing, like you said.
Oh right, was, yeah.
But there's a some. I wasn't sure if it was George or whoever working on you, but I knew it was you between the blonde hair and the workout tank top you had. That gray.
Yes.
But I yes. Look at Brooke, you know, it was fun. They were working on one of your arms, which was funny.
Oh my God, that's so funny. Yeah, the arms were crazy. People always ask me about the arms, and so I always try to throw it in. They were actually, I think, made out of some kind of fiberglass. So they were light, and they were every little part of the arms, they were on hinges. So I actually manually worked them, but just by moving them back and forth, they, you know, they kind of, you know, do the motion of the wave. I don't know what it's called, the, you know, just the movement of it. And then I had these little, I had this like wrap around my whole waist, and it had kind of like backward cones, and I'd put my elbows into the openings. And so that kind of completed the arm. And then there were handles inside, and I could hold onto the handles, and that's how I moved them back and forth. And then Screamin' would drape all the flesh all over it and then airbrush it and get all the guts coming out and all that wonderful stuff. And that still took about 3 hours to do that, to do the arms. So
yeah, but it was actually your real arm that they had painting up or whatever. I guess it was glue, or
I know what they were doing. So a lot of people don't know this. In the very end scene where I get crushed, right before I get crushed, the bug in the foreground is myself. I'm in this big, huge bug costume from like my butt all the way to my head. It was huge. It was like I had to get inside it. And the head of the costume was worked by, you know, remote control and the wire, the cables and all of that stuff, by the special effects guys off camera. But I was in that bug suit. And so I know exactly what they were doing. I had these rubber gloves all the way past my elbows, and they were probably airbrushing them to blend in to the cockroach costume. So like I was doing push-ups the whole time in this cockroach costume. So I had to like lay down, and my hands were kind of in front of me bent, and then they'd go action, and I'd pop up and I'd move all around. And so that's me in the costume. And if you watch carefully, you can kind of see the outlines of my arms, but it's very hard to see. You'd never know if you weren't told that I have my hands are right there, but they're totally blended in. You can't see them.
Hey, Elena, you got one?
I do. Brookie, how does it feel to know that you're a part of a hugely pivotal franchise and you made a mark on horror history?
Yeah, it's pretty. It's very cool because, first of all, I love horror. I'm a big horror fan myself. And my brother, I had a brother who was 4 years older than me. And he was into all the classic horrors from, you know, Creature from the Black Lagoon to Frankenstein and all of those. So, and he would get books and magazines, you know, like I guess what Fangoria would be today. But he had these hardcover and softcover big books. And I remember I would go into his room and I'd flip through them, and they were fun and creepy. And he was very into horror, so he kind of introduced me to horror. And so being part of a, you know, iconic classic franchise is mind-blowing, really. It's I just got lucky. Like I said, I was so excited. People are like, I just booked the job. I was so excited the fact that I got to turn into a cockroach. I remember reading the script going, oh gee, I wonder how they're gonna do that, having no clue the kind of practical, you know, makeup and effects that they did at the time. And so as I started getting involved with that, it was pretty cool to watch it jump from the page to the screen. So, but I really had no idea, you know, the intricacies and the detail that's involved with practical makeup and effects. So yeah, so to be something part of pop culture and a pop icon or whatever is really, I don't know, just a feather in my cap. I have a handful of those in my cap and this is definitely one of them.
That's awesome. So yes, I am going to end with another eclectic question to finish Nightmare. And ask you, if you could go back to playing Debbie again with all your experience that you have and knowledge that you have now, would you change anything?
Everything.
Okay.
Oh, it's so hard. It's like watching, when I watch it, I cringe at a lot of stuff. I think just, I would change how I wouldn't change anything about Debbie. I would just change line delivery. I think that would be about it.
Right.
Oh God. Yeah. Like, oh, I hate how I say that line. Oh God, it's terrible. Oh Lord. It's very painful sometimes to watch. And then you just have to let it go and enjoy it.
And no, I'm not going to start singing a Frozen song.
I know, please ride. Yeah. Especially with the 3-year-old niece around. I'm sure.
Yes.
Yeah.
But curious to know, you know, because I mentioned in the intro, and hopefully this is true, that your most important role is being a wife and mom. What do your kids think about your pop culture status with both TV and movie fame?
Yes, being a mom and a wife really is my most important role. So all I ever really wanted to be was a mom. So I wanted 6 kids, and then I had a boy first, and I was like, I'm done. One and done. I'm like, oh my God, this is really, 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 really hard. He almost killed himself twice, no joke, getting into everything, and a couple ambulance trips to the hospital. So that was really fun. I was like, yeah, I just have to keep this kid alive, so I can't have any more children. But then, of course, I had my daughter 13 years later. So, my kids think it's – my daughter thinks it's really cool. She thinks I'm like a movie star. And I'm like, oh, honey, no, I'm not a movie star. And so she loves to go. I brought her to several conventions. And I actually got to – they played the movie at Man's Chinese Theater here in Hollywood. Grauman's Chinese Theater, I don't know what they call it anymore, and so she got to see the film on the big screen, actual, like, you know, 35 millimeter tape. It was really cool. So she thinks it's pretty cool. And my son wants, he's a bio major, so he was like, sure, I'm not doing any of that acting stuff, it's way too hard. So yeah, but my daughter would love to be a singer. But she also wants to be a veterinarian, which is really funny that she wants to be exactly what I was. And I did not influence her. Purple is my favorite color. It is not hers. So, my daughter thinks it's pretty cool. And like I said, my son laughs and he reads comments on my Facebook page and he'll text me like, Mom. And I was like, what? He goes, well, this guy said like, you're really beautiful and for something. I'm like, come on. Give me a little credit here, you know. So he's really funny. He gets very protective. If anybody comments anything, it's very funny. Love that boy. He's 25 and my daughter just turned 12, so there's a big age difference, and so it's very funny.
But
they're very,
you know,
funny.
That's an interesting point, and I know we agreed to. Do we have a few more minutes with you since schedule?
Yeah.
Change?
Yes. Okay, yes. Absolutely.
Okay. I just don't want to, you know, change up, but. Speaking of the age difference there, and I actually asked a recent guest, I believe it was last week, who has 3 kids, and the one came a little later.
Yes.
She had the child in her 40s, which God bless her.
Oh,
I always said, and most parents agree with me, when you're younger and you have your kids, you have the energy, but you don't have the patience. But yet when you're older, you have the patience.
But, see, and I feel the exact opposite. I was a much better mother younger. My poor daughter. I have no patience for my daughter. I'm like, I'll be yelling at her. I'm like, I never yelled at my son the way I yell at my daughter. So I think I suck as an older parent. And I was so lax. My son would he was crazy. So he'd be like up in the tree 30 feet high. And I'm like, just use your best judgment.
You know? So it's, you know? So it sounds like you're going to have a whole lot of fun as she gets ready to enter her teenage years.
Oh God, I got to hold on. It's going to be a bumpy ride. Oh. Yeah. She's a feisty one. So yeah, but you know, I think as I step back, as I realize how fast it goes, I think I appreciate moments with my daughter way more than I did with my son. You just don't realize it when you're in the thick of it with children, and it's hard to see out of the forest because it's all encompassing when you have young children. And so now I think I do appreciate, even though when I get mad and obviously I apologize and go, okay, I'm sorry I yelled at you. If anybody yelled at you, I'd beat them up. So don't ever let anybody yell at you.
Well, you know, that's fascinating how you say that. But when you look back, as you said, and obviously hindsight's 20/20.
Yes.
We talked about your parents as well.
Yes.
But what kind of kid were you growing up, would you say?
I was a total tomboy. I was massively independent. My parents got divorced when I was 10, and they were not, you know, very happy together before that. So I just was really independent. I was a total tomboy because of my brother. Loved horror, loved climbing trees, loved dirt, loved lizards. And so I was always out. Like, we lived close to the beach, and so I was just out, and I would, you know, it was the 70s I grew up in, and the 80s I was a teenager, but in the 70s, you know, you went outside and you didn't come home until the porch light, you know, turned on. So yeah, we had a lot of freedom, and I think there's a beauty in that kind of freedom that our kids don't have. My kids certainly didn't have. And so I think that breeds independence. And so I was incredibly independent. I left my house by 17 years old. I went to NYU, Tisch School of the Arts, and I was gone, and I never came home. So I was just independent, kind of, you know, digging the dirt kind of chick. Until I got into high school, and then boys became very important. I was more like Wendy than I was Debbie.
Because I was going to say, my nephew's the same way. He's 20 months old, and he's the kid you got to worry about.
Yeah.
You're not the kid that your parents had to worry about?
No, I was a good kid. I mean, I struggled in school because I have dyslexia, but no, I was a really good kid. I didn't drink, I didn't smoke, I didn't party, like that kind of stuff. I was very helpful around the house. If, you know, there was a leak, I'd fix it. If the TV broke, I'd fix it. Cause I became the man of the house at like 10 years old. So my mom didn't worry about me at all like that. No, I was a good kid in terms of that. Didn't give her a lot, too much grief. Of course, if you ask her, she might say differently, but I really didn't.
Well, Elena educated me something here about your career that I wasn't familiar with. So I'll let her bring this up. Elena, okay.
Yes, we bring up, speaking of older people and being an older parent and all that stuff, Brookie, yes. Please tell us about your role on The Golden Palace, the spinoff of The Golden Girls.
Oh, The Golden Palace, Betty White. So I played Betty White's granddaughter. And I look at back now and I'm like, again, what a feather in my cap to have worked with Betty White. And we had a lot of scenes together, and lovely, gracious, kind woman, funny woman, just what you see is what you get with her. And so that was, again, that was just, I have had so much luck in my career, because really it's all about luck. I mean, you have a little bit of talent and you're in the right place at the right time and right people representing you, but it's a lot of luck. And getting that role, again, as I look back, I'm like, oh my gosh, you know, I would love to run into her one day and go, oh my God, I played your granddaughter in the Golden Palace and I love you so much. And what a career she's had. I think all of us envy her and aspire to be her. And she's just, you know, she's pretty spectacular.
You were very well cast, Brookie. Like, you genuinely kind of resemble her, and you had that like really like innocent vibe about you. I loved it so much. So
cool. Oh, thanks. It was fun. It was a cute show. It was. I remember. I didn't know how to say. Blanche's character says, yeah. "You know, she's. You know, I say something about dating people or dating boys or whatever, and I say, well, you know, Blanche told me, and then she's like, well, what did she say? And I was like, well, she actually said I date many, many, many boys. And I don't know the line, not getting the line right, but I remember
you did. I actually wrote that down in my notes to actually bring that scene up, because that was my ass off.
Yeah, Rue McClanahan had to, like, I was like, how would you say this? And she was like, oh, I would say, men, men, men. And I was like, oh, perfect. Okay. Ding, ding, ding. So funny.
That's amazing that you brought that up, because I genuinely was just about to say, that scene makes me laugh so much.
I know, right? It was so fun. I mean, working with all those gals was, I mean, it was pretty cool. Pretty cool. And the fact that Betty White is still going is just like, oh, she's just so inspirational. I'm like, oh, I want to be that. I want to be her. I want to be acting until I'm 100. It's so cool. It's just that's the coolest thing about acting, because I've left the industry for a while. And, you know, it's never gone. It's always there. And, you know, when you're a performer or an artist, you always are to the core. And so the fact that that kind of creativity and that kind of career never really goes away. So is very inspiring to me.
But speaking of which, the at least last area I want to bring up, and I know Elena knows a little bit about it as well, is, do we have to have grief with your husband, Brian, in terms of the role he wrote you in the alternate, being the heel?
What do you mean? I'm confused. What do you mean?
Because we're not used to seeing you be the bad girl. So.
Oh, right. I know. That was fun. I got to beat up, you know, Eric Roberts. It doesn't get better, much better than that. No, that was so fun. That was so fun. Yeah, no, he wrote that part for me, which was very cool. And the fight scene, I worked my ass off on.
We have got a little bad news here for you. You actually dropped off at the beginning of that answer.
Oh, I'm sorry. So you want me to repeat it?
Yes, if you could.
Yeah. It was very cool that my husband wrote that part for me and believed in me that I could do that scene, because I don't know what you heard, but I was very nervous about the fight scene. It was one of those things where you're like, I don't know if I can do this part because I'm terrified of the fight scene. And I worked really hard. I remember working out in the backyard with the big, huge, it was a wooden stick, not a metal stick, and practicing and over and over and over again. And Brian working with me, because he's a martial artist. And he actually does, one of the things he does is, he'll teach all the actors their fight scenes. He worked for New Image, which was a New Image movie, which is now Millennium, and they just do so many movies. But that was kind of, he would always do choreograph all the fight scenes with the actors and stuff. And so he was working with me, and I got some special attention, thank God, because it was scary doing that fight scene, because I didn't think I was going to be able to do it. But I was very grateful that he trusted me that I could pull it off.
Yeah, it happens. You knew the writer.
Say that. Yeah, it happens to know the writer, right?
Yeah.
So, yeah, definitely.
Elena, didn't you have something else for this role as well?
Oh, yeah. I was just going to say, no spoilers, but I bet you were really mad at Brian for how the end of the fight ends.
Right? I'm like, yeah. Thanks a whole bunch.
Oh boy. I will say this, because somebody brought this up with the picture we used to promote that Brooke was going to be here. Was
yes.
That classic scene in the parking lot from Nightmare 4. Somebody asked in a message about it to my personal account.
So yes.
I said, you know, the good thing about that picture, I said, when I grow up, you can't tell with the video how I am now with the flannel shirt and everything.
Yes.
But I hope to have abs like Brooke one day when I grow up.
Believe me, I'd like to have abs like Brooke did when she was back 18 years old. Yes, yeah. Then sometimes I always wondered, like, why did they pick me to be a workout queen? I was like, I was just a cheerleader. And then I look at myself and I'm like, oh, okay, I get it.
Yeah. And yes. Of course, Elena brought it up as well when we first jumped on the line to do sound check and all. I hope to grow the hair as well.
Right? Well, I can buy you an 80s wig anytime and we can make that work for you.
Awesome. Yeah, because between my niece yesterday saying it, then Elena, first words out of her mouth was, you got a haircut. Oh, so.
Yeah. Thanks so much.
Yeah, it's like, yeah. Well, it's easier to do with the house here because of this whole COVID stuff.
Yes, yeah, so. It is. It's very true. I think we've all become professional hairdressers through this COVID time.
Yeah, it took a while to find a pair of clippers, but I found them.
Right, you know, it does. It takes a little. Those clippers are hard. I've done my husband. I'm like, I'm not really good at that. And so I think I nicked him one time. And so I'm like, I'm so sorry.
Well, I think you may have owed him one for something at some point.
Pardon?
You might have owed him one for something along the way.
Oh, yeah. I owe him a lot. A lot. Oh, God. Too funny.
To wrap up here, do you have anything upcoming that you'd like to promote? I did see something on Instagram.
Yeah, so I'm actually coming out of retirement for a little bit. I'm going to do a project called Seasons, a horror film. Actually, Lisa Wilcox and Danny Hassel are going to be in it as well. And it's a really fun movie. It really kind of reminds me of Creepshow. I don't know if you remember Creepshow, the movie, not the TV show. They did a movie with Ted Danson, I think it was in, but it was a bunch of vignettes. So this is kind of, it's all four seasons and it's all full of vignettes, and it's, I love the writing and I love the concept. And so I agreed to do it. So I'm actually really, excited about that and looking forward to it.
Elena?
I don't know when it's going to be out. We haven't even shot it yet. So, I think it's December, January, it'll be shooting. So it's very exciting. So watch out for it.
They mentioned 2021. So
yeah. Yeah, yeah. Definitely. It'll be fun. Of course, I'm terrified because I haven't acted forever. So it's, you know, it's the normal fears of actors and insecurities.
Oh, I'm sure you'll be fine, Brooke.
I'm like, do I remember how to do that? Do I remember what acting's like? But it'll be fun. I'm looking forward to it. Really, I am.
I'm looking forward to when the cons are back so we can all
come out again. I know. They've been really creative through this whole, I mean, we all as humans have been very creative through COVID. I think this whole COVID time, we've actually really learned what the importance of family is and time. And we kind of had this, I look at COVID, and now obviously I'm very blessed to not have lost anybody through COVID. And my hearts go out to people that have. But having been stuck at home, having to be stuck at home, it was a really little gift of time with my daughter and my family. And my son came home a couple of times. He lives in NorCal. And it was a really precious time. And I'm very grateful for it. And I think we were very creative with what we did. I think people realized that, oh, I can work from home. And I think a lot of companies realize they're employees are very happy working from home. I think they learned that we could, you know, that they could rent less space, save money that way. And people are home and working from home, and they're like, they can take a break and walk their dog and eat their lunch with their whoever's home in their house. And so I think as humans, we've really been creative. And I hope The vaccine comes out. I hope people will take it when it's safe. When Fauci says, that's when I'm taking mine. we will get through this, and we are all here, and we're all working forward, moving forward to getting back to normal life. And it will be really fun to go back to cons.
So I'm actually going to think you're listening to scientists and people who actually study that kind of thing.
Yes.
How about that? How about that? If more people would actually do that, we'd be all right.
Yeah, we'd be all right. You have to look at it like this. If you take a normal vaccine for the flu, and I know some people don't, and I respect whatever, we're all different. And, we go to the doctor, we believe in the science of x-rays and mammograms and all of that stuff. There's science behind it. And so let's let them do their job and us listen. And, they talk about going back to school and the kids need to be back at school. And sometimes I go, I'm not saying I'm either way for that. My daughter's home, but it's like, if you're touting education, let's listen to the people who are educated. Let's listen to them, please.
Yes. On that note, we are definitely going to share, if you people want information or to follow Brooke, we will share the Instagram and all that, where she's very active.
Perfect. And
yeah, that's the best way to follow her, because she's everybody's favorite bug girl.
Yes. Instagram is definitely better. Facebook, I've been a little active just because of the election and stuff, but I don't go, I'll be months off of Facebook. So Instagram really is the place to find me.
Elena, do you have any closing remarks?
Closing remarks. Turkey train a turd.
Yes. Turkey train a turd. Sounds horrible, but it's so fun.
Brooke, thank you so much.
You guys are so welcome. Jonathan, Elena, thank you for taking the time and having me on. I really appreciate it.
Not all football helmets are created equal. Zenith, the industry leader in protective technology, is the only helmet in the game with adaptive head protection featuring a shock suspension system that can move independently from the helmet shell. Headquartered and developed in Detroit, Zenith is committed to player safety and revolutionary innovation. Zenith is proud to protect athletes at every level, from peewee to the pros. Learn more about the Zenith difference at zenith.com. That's XENITH.com.
Hi, this is Troy Newkirk, Sheila from Nightmare on Elm Street, and you're listening to Crazy Train Radio.